Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 27th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to agree to take agenda item 4 in private today. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. The second item is to consider taking the committee's business next week, Thursday the 17th of November, in private. Are we all agreed on that? We are agreed. Thank you very much. The principal purpose of our meeting this morning is to hold a round table to take evidence on the Accounts Commission Auditor General's report on tackling child poverty, which came out in September of this year. And can I welcome our witnesses to this morning's committee? We very much appreciate you being here and giving up your time, and we're looking forward to hearing the evidence that you're going to give us about your understanding of where things are. We are a public audit committee, so we will be asking questions about what it's like out there for children growing up in Scotland at the moment, but we also want to spend a bit of time looking at the data, looking at the funding, but looking at delivery and outcomes. Can I just say to our witnesses this morning, if you want to come in at any point, just indicate to myself or to the clerks and we'll do our best to bring you in. Don't feel obliged to that you have to answer every question that's put, but if you are particularly keen to come in, we'll do our very best to bring you in. One of the outcomes that we're hoping from today is that we will get some good quality information that will help feed into the work that the Auditor General has said that he wants to continue doing on child poverty. It's something which he's prioritised, and so we hope that this morning's session will inform his work as well as the work of this committee, and indeed I'm sure the work of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, which is also carrying out an investigation at the moment into child poverty and the relationship between child poverty and parental employability. But can I start by asking members of the committee as well as members of the panel to introduce themselves before we go to the first question. And I'll begin, Auditor General, with you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I'm Stephen Boyle. I'm the Auditor General for Scotland.
Yeah, no, thank you. I'm John Dickey. I'm Director of the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland.
I'm Bill Kidd, Member of Scottish Parliament for Glasgow and East Land.
I'm Paul Johnston. I'm Director General for Communities in the Scottish Government.
I'm Bill Scott, Chair of the Poverty and Inequality Commission for Scotland.
Craig Hoy, MSP for South Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Hannah McCulloch. I'm National Coordinator for Local Child Poverty Action Reports with the Improvement Service.
Hey. Morning, I'm Ryan McQuigg, Campaigns, Advocacy and Policy for Action for Children Scotland.
Colin Beattie, MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh.
Matthew Sweeney, I'm a Policy Manager in the Children and Young People team at COSLA.
Sharon Dowie, MSP for South Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Bruce Edmondson. I've got the best job in the world because I'm the Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland, so it's my role to safeguard and promote the rights of children.
Thank you very much indeed, and the human rights of children is something that we will come to quite early on. Bruce, can I put my first question to John Dickey from the Child Poverty Action Group? And that is, whilst we are an audit committee, we are also in the human face of what's happening out there. And I just wonder, John, perhaps you could start us off by perhaps drawing on your experience to give some examples of the impact living in poverty has had and the experiences that you've drawn on from children and families themselves who are living below the poverty line.
Yeah, no, thank you. I mean, quite extraordinary impact, and we often talk about the statistics, and the briefing refers to the impact that poverty has on children's health, their education, their well-being, measurable impact. But of course, it has a real impact on just children's day-to-day lives, on their sense of identity, on their well-being, on their very ability to just enjoy their childhoods. I mean, terms of some of the feedback we've had, we work through our Cost of School Day project, for example, in schools, involving children and young people in schools to identify barriers to involvement at school that are created by poverty, by financial barriers. One of those young people spoke to us and said, if all your friends go to the school trips, go on the school outings, I'm paraphrasing, but school trips, after school clubs, that kind of isolates you from them. You're singled out, you're not with them, you're just a spare person. And that kind of, gives a sense of what it feels like to a child to be not having the resources to participate with their peers. Others talk about the experience of being bullied. One person told us about one young person, because they were wearing the same shoes since P7, they were being picked out and being asked, or being told, you must be poor, and were being bullied in their own words. They talk about letting others down, one young person telling us that because they weren't able to bring in a cash contribution to some classroom activity, that they were letting the class down. So they take it on themselves and they feel it. We know that parents go to extraordinary lengths to try and protect their children from the impact of poverty. So many children are protected. Families, parents will go without food themselves in order to feed their children. They'll put on a brave face, a mask. But we also know that at times that's just untenable, particularly at the moment, with the extraordinary increases in prices tipping families over the edge. No longer got, we used to talk about impossible choices. The choices are just evaporating now for parents. And that does have an impact on parents' mental well-being, and then that impacts on children feel that stress as well. Another example would be when children talk about the other way around. Children try to protect their parents from how poverty impacts on their day-to-day life. Maybe not mentioning that school trip that cost. There's been a charge for not mentioning that there's actually an after-school club that they could be going to, or a football match, or that their friends have asked them to go swimming or whatever, and they don't ask. So it's that kind of clearly huge amounts of long-term damage being done in terms of education health, but that kind of just damage the day-to-day life of children in Scotland, because their families just don't have the incomes that are needed to give them a decent start in life and to be able to just participate like they're better off peers.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, one of the things that always occurs to me is that children are only 5 once, they're only 10 once, and if we don't get this right now, there's an urgency to this, John, isn't there? And unless we get this right now, it's going to change the course of those young people's lives.
Exactly, and every opportunity we miss, every year that goes past, that's a generation of children that have been affected, impacted unnecessarily by that lack of opportunity, by the stress that poverty has caused them and their families. And I suppose that's something hopefully we'll come on to talk about. Just a lot of the building blocks are now in place, and a lot of the we understand what's needed. I think there's a shared understanding around this table of what's needed to end child poverty in Scotland and to meet those child poverty targets. But I think there's a big issue around scale and pace, so that we actually deliver on that and ensure that a 5-year-old, a 10-year-old next year, the year after, doesn't have to miss out at school, doesn't have to end up in a queue at a food bank with their mum. There's an urgency around this.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to come in on this question? Yeah, Ryan.
Families have told us that poverty limits their children's opportunities, freedoms, choices, and fundamentally their rights. And families have to make the heartbreaking decision, you can call it decision, even feeding the meter or trying to feed their family. And it's that constant stress. But also families and children feel isolated and abandoned, not just from their peers, but from the state, who is meant to help the families. For example, we've got some of our support workers went in to see a family when their child was off school because they had cold feet, and found out it was chilblains. Because they didn't have any shoes, they had to, when they come home, they had to wear their coats. Other families tell us when kids come home straight from school, they're straight in bed to keep warm, and they eat dinner, what little dinner they have there. They can't invite their friends over, and in fact, one mother said that they encourage their son to go to their friend's house because they'll know they'll get a biscuit, they'll get something to drink and it'll be warm. We've had families that have had to rely on a camping stove to heat their food that they have. And we've had a nine-year-old boy just recently say to their mum, don't get me any Christmas presents because I know we don't have any money. Don't do Christmas dinner. Christmas is just an ordinary day for us. And as you say, that's not childhood. That's children are aware, and it's right that they're aware of the facts, but they shouldn't have to be stressed about everyday life. And I think, you know, we call it a shame that Scotland has this poverty, but it should, we should be sick with anger that it's happening. And that is just some of the stories. There's plenty more that I can give you, but it's, this is the real life that people, if you can call it that, because one mother said, it's just impossible, we literally can't live. And that shouldn't happen today, in the third decade of the 21st century.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, there's a famous John Steinbeck quote, isn't there, which says, the line between hunger and anger is a very thin line. And that kind of sums up what you're saying. Bill Scott, you wanted to come in, Bill.
Yeah, I think there's a misunderstanding about the scale of poverty in Scotland. Most of us, when we refer to relative poverty, about one in four children. But work by my colleague, the Vice-Chair of the Commission, has shown that in the first 10 years of life, a majority of Scottish children will experience poverty, at least in one of those years, and often for two or three of those years. And that, we then go on to talk about how adverse childhood experiences impact on children's lives when they become adults. And we know, again, that poverty is a huge indicator of whether they will have adverse childhood experiences, because relationship breakdown is much more likely when your parents are living in poverty. Homelessness is far more likely when your parents are living in poverty. So the impact on children's lives does not stop when they're children. That stigma is carried into adulthood. And again, we know that the pandemic had an enormous impact on children and young people's mental health. And that is being exacerbated by the new cost of living crisis. And, you know, JRF, the Joseph Roundy Foundation, have carried out a large-scale survey, and they've found 4 million children in the UK are now living without adequate access to food. And that has increased in households with children by 50% since April of this year. That's, you know, children are literally going hungry, but as John and Ryan have said, the impact on their parents as well. One of our experts by experience panel is a mother of children, a lone parent, and she says, I can't remember the last time I had 3 proper meals. I take a lot of pain medication and I need to take them with food. But at the minute, I might get 1 proper meal in the evening, and for breakfast and lunch, it's a slice of toast, maybe a biscuit to take with meals. And again, the JRF research shows 9.7 million adults, nearly 1 in 5 households in the UK, have gone without food on one or more day during October. You know, this is before winter has really hit. This is the impact on families right now. And as I say, that impact doesn't stop. It goes on, and children's lives are affected. Their life expectancy is affected. Their mental health is affected. And I absolutely agree. It's something we need to be angry about and really be determined to take action on, because we should not tolerate it.
Thank you. I'm going to move on now and bring in Bill Kidd, who's got a question to put. Bill.
Yep. Thank you very much, convener. Can I ask a question specifically? It's a more technical question of Bruce Adamson, the Commissioner. And can I ask the Commissioner's opinion and responses on the extent to which the Scottish Government's plan to tackle child poverty supports a rights-based approach in line with the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child? So it's to try and see how we here in Scotland and the Scottish, in terms of what the Scottish Government's plan is, actually resonates with the Convention on the Rights of the Child, please.
We need to start by poverty is a human rights issue. It was the biggest human rights issue facing children and young people when I started this job 5.5 years ago. That was before the pandemic. That was before the recent exceptional increases in cost of living. And it's hugely concerning. We aren't doing enough. And the continuation of child poverty is a political failure and a political choice. And so we need to make sure that we're taking a proper rights-based approach and seeing this as a state's obligation. And so traditionally we've often talked about poverty and child poverty as linked to the right to an adequate standard of living, a safe, warm home, good, nutritious food. I've started now to talk about it much more as a right to survival and development, because the failure to properly address child poverty is having a catastrophic effect to children across Scotland, and we aren't doing enough to address that. And so the direct links to the right to education, so an education which develops children to their fullest potential. Children are being absolutely failed because they're not able to access education in the same way. We're hearing again stories about children not going to school because they've not got the school uniform, or they're being bullied, they're not able to engage in that full school experience of school trips and things like that. They're going to school hungry. So the real importance of things like school meals are absolutely key. And then the disproportionate effect on some groups of children and young people, disabled children, children with disabled family members, young carers, care-experienced children, black and minority ethnic children, children of prisoners, children in single-parent families, and recognising the gender-based impact of poverty as well, larger families. And so we need to do a lot more to make sure that we're focusing attention on supporting children. Children have told us, one child said, when you're poor, you give up on your dreams. I mean, this is how kind of visceral that it is. Another said, when I think of poverty, I think of inequality. It's not fair and it's not right. And another said, and I think this is crucially important, the most unfair thing is that the government knows that families are going through hard times but decide not to do anything about it. So it's really important when we're looking at government planning that we're setting this within the context of the obligation within the Convention on the Rights of the Child to use all available resources to the maximum extent possible. And I think that there needs to be much more focused on public budgeting, human rights budgeting at all levels to ensure that we're demonstrating that use of all available resources to the maximum extent possible. That's not yet happening. I think that there's also another big human rights gap in terms of participation of children and young people, particularly those children and young people who are most directly affected by poverty. We could be doing a lot more about ensuring that their voices and experiences help develop some of the planning and the responses to that. But while I welcome the Scottish Government's focus on child poverty, I welcome the fact that this committee and other committees are taking your responsibility seriously as human rights guarantors. We are failing children at the moment. We are not doing enough. And I think that children and young people are rightly angry, and they're sadly losing hope, which I think is hugely concerning. So I think there needs to be a much greater level of urgency. There needs to be a much stronger focus on the human rights obligations on states, recognising the right that children and young people have to benefit from social security, the right to an adequate standard of living, the right to be involved in decision-making, the right to have decisions made in their best interest, but particularly the obligation on the state to use all available resources to the maximum extent possible and to make sure that we can demonstrate that. And as we move towards fulfilling the commitment to incorporate the Convention on the Rights of the Child into our domestic law, which I hope will be back before Parliament very shortly, I think this is going to be one of the real issues that we need to focus on at every single level. Are we able to demonstrate that we've properly taken a rights-based approach to budgeting and ensuring that children's voices and experiences are part of that and that we're actually delivering? Because at the moment, I don't think that we are.
Okay, thank you. Can I just follow up?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that, because that's a proper background to the whole issue, and not just a support, because sometimes you can say you support something, but you know, that's more putting a signature on a line and that's the end of it, sort of thing, you know. Can I ask though that the Scottish Child Payment and the introduction and such like, how much do you think that might have impacted in terms of what you're describing there, please?
Yeah, it's hugely positive. I mean, people have described it as a lifeline. Again, we need to start accelerating the provision of getting direct financial support to families. So we should be looking to make sure that we can increase that and ensure that payments are getting to families. There's a lot that can be done around making sure that families are getting everything that they're entitled to. But again, the organisations around the table who've been doing amazing campaigning work on this will say that it's hugely positive. These payments can be an absolute lifeline, but we're not doing enough. We need to do more. Obviously, a lot of social security powers are reserved to Westminster, and that's why I'm working very closely with my colleague Children's Commissioners in the other devolved jurisdictions in particular to put focus on the UK government as well, which needs to do a lot more around social security. But at Scottish Government level and at local authority level, we need to make sure that everyone is doing everything that they can. So we would say that there are some really positive steps, but they need to be escalated and increased because they're not meeting the demand.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I mean, one of the recommendations of the or key messages of the Accounts Commission Audit Scotland report is number four, the views of children and families living in poverty are not always meaningfully considered as policies and actions are developed, implemented and evaluated. And that pretty much is what you've said, Bruce, isn't it? I don't know whether, I mean, I don't want to put Paul Johnson on the spot, but I think it would be useful to get a view from the Scottish Government about that and whether you accept that as something where improvements are required. Paul?
Can I just say from the outset, convener, that I really welcome this discussion. I'm grateful for it, and I do not intend for a minute to be here as the government official seeking to in any way say that we've got this all nailed. We clearly don't. I accept all that we've heard and the harrowing stories that we've heard already. And I hope we're all around the table determined to do all that we can to address the issues of child poverty that we've heard about. I think colleagues around the table recognise that this government has identified tackling child poverty as a key priority. And as we've just heard, the Scottish Child Payment is hugely significant in that regard. And so I hope we can come on to that in a bit more detail, given that the expansion is happening this very month. And of course, we are seeking to develop policy by taking into account the views of children and young people, to answer your particular point, convener. Could we do more? Yes. And that's something that we are looking at every single area of policy that's set out in Best Start, Bright Futures, our new plan, to say how can we ensure that the voices, the experiences, the views of children, young people and parents inform the way in which we go about delivery. We have heard their perspectives in developing the plan. We do work closely with a number of the organisations around the table, and in particular benefit from the Experts by Experience panel that Bill has already referred to. So it is part of our policy making. We are determined to ensure that it's all the more a part of our policy making as we proceed. And any assistance from the committee and from other panel members in that is very welcome.
Okay, thank you. Bill, I'll just bring you in.
Yep. Very briefly, I referred to the Experts by Experience panel. The Commission established the Experts by Experience panel so that we could work in partnership with those directly experiencing poverty to develop our own policies and recommendations to Scottish Government. And they were very much at the heart of our recommendations on the new Child Poverty Delivery Plan. We worked with Bruce's office to make sure that children's and young people's views were taken on board. And at the moment, the Commission are carrying out a series of cost of living visits to local projects to speak directly, again, to people experiencing poverty as a consequence of the cost of living crisis. And one of the most concerning things that we're hearing on those visits are the number of families whose parents are in work, are getting all the benefits they're entitled to, but are still not able to pay their fuel and food bills. And that is a huge concern because it means that poverty is spreading up, out with those that we've up until now considered as households that are getting by. they're no longer getting by. They are now experiencing poverty. And that's going to be a huge concern going forward for Scottish Government, for everybody in Scottish society.
Thank you. One of the themes in the report is a return to the Christie Commission and the importance of preventative strategies. And it's a joint report by, as I mentioned, Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission. So in the next section, I think we want to bring in our folk with the local authority experience as well as a central government experience. But I'm going to ask Colin Beattie to put forward a series of questions and points. Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. Very usefully, the Auditor General has summarised on page 5 of his report the different areas of responsibility between the UK Government, Scottish Government and local government. And it's quite clear the vast majority of levers remain in the hands of the UK Government, which doesn't mean, of course, that the Scottish Government and local government are absolved from the actions that they take. So the question I would ask is, how can the Scottish Government and local authorities make a shift towards more preventative action while at the same time helping kids that are currently living in poverty? And maybe since Matthew's next to me here, he might be the first person to...
Absolutely, no, and I think it's a really important question, and I think it's something that obviously has caused that we're absolutely signed up to the Christie Commission, absolutely, in all of its recommendations. Obviously, we've touched already about the importance of involving communities and how you design and implement services, but also that very key point about prevention. And I think the report notes, I think, one of the really good examples of prevention that's ongoing through early learning and childcare expansion, which was a really big joint project between local authorities and the Scottish Government. And that managed to do both. At the same time, there were savings delivered for families just now, but also there's that investment in young people or children at that really important stage before they're 5 years old, which we hope are going to have those impacts on the poverty-related attainment gap as they go forward. I suppose the challenge when it comes to prevention, I think it's one you sort of hinted at in your question there, is we've come off of sort of two crises. We came through COVID, and then so much of what we were doing was how do we move into that crisis response. And local authorities had obviously had such a big role when they were delivering free school meals during the holidays, when they were, you know, delivering the bridging payments while the Scottish Child Payment came online. And the capacity that takes up makes it challenging to, at the same time, do that more preventative and long-term work. But I think what we're trying to do is do both of them at the same time. And I think if you look across the drivers which are set out in the plan, there's some of them where local authorities are very focused on that sort of short-term mitigation response. But there is also work in employability about what we can do to support families. There's work through tackling the poverty-related attainment gap. So I suppose it's challenging. It's going to become more challenging, I think, in the financial context that we've got ahead. But I think local authorities, and I think for the Scottish Government as well, although I'll let Paul perhaps speak to that, they are trying to get that balance.
Perhaps Hannah might be keen to come in at that point.
Yeah. Excuse me. Yeah, absolutely. As Matthew says, over the last few years, local authorities have had to have a very a crisis-focused response to the pandemic and also the cost of living crisis. And I think they've done that effectively in quite a dignified way. They've sort of tried to take a cash-first approach where possible. So, you know, that's ongoing. When you look across the local child poverty action reports, which are the annual reports that local authorities and their planning partners produce, you can see that there is a willingness and a desire, and there is a beginning of engaging those more strategic preventative policy levers. So we see reports touch on housing, economic development, employability, childcare. Those levers are being engaged, and they're part of the discussion, but I think there's still a long way to go. From looking at the reports, you can see that while these areas are mentioned, we really need to drive down deeper into sharpening the focus on the particular impact that these policy areas can have on families with children, and the priority families in particular. So yes, it's good to have affordable housing, but is it in the right places that families can get their children to school? Is it suitable for large families and that kind of thing? And really, we really need to be more targeted in that way. And also, not just sort of listing, well, we've got housing, we've got childcare, we've got planning. It's what is the vision of how these things work together to create communities where there are quality jobs that parents can take up because they have affordable childcare, they have good transport links, and really having that holistic outlook. And we're beginning to see that. Those that are leading on this locally cite the practical barriers that stop that from happening. So whether it's capacity, getting those people round the table, people having different funding constraints and budgets, different reporting requirements, working towards different outcomes. There's legal barriers in terms of data sharing. So none of these things are insurmountable, but they really need high-level strategic joined-up thinking, both at local level and at national level. And I think we are starting to see that. We have the Tackling Child Poverty Programme Board, for instance. At local level, local reports tend to be developed and signed off by community planning partnerships rather than councils alone. So we are starting to see that, but absolutely it's not enough and it's not happening fast enough.
Paul, you're an obvious person to come in now, but what I would ask you is maybe to comment on my original statement, which was about most of the levers are with Westminster. How do we link in with Westminster's child poverty policies? I presume they've got some. I mean, I haven't seen them, but I presume they exist, and that the Scottish Government links in with that to try and create an effective response to this. But again, back to the question also that how can better preventative action be taken while dealing with the current situation of children in poverty?
Yeah. I think as a matter of fact, it's only the Scottish Parliament that has the legal target now in terms of where we need to get to, where we must get to on child poverty by 2030, and that those targets do not exist at a UK government level. I probably shouldn't say much more in terms of what Scottish ministers would want to argue that the UK government should do. Clearly, some of that is into political space. What I would say is that our new child poverty delivery plan, Best Start, Bright Future, does set out our need to work very closely across all of Scotland with all partners, and that must include the UK government. And what I've seen at first hand over recent months is very close working between Scottish Government, DWP, local government and third sector organisations in some of our pathfinders. Now, the plan sets out the pathfinder work, which we are undertaking in Dundee and Glasgow. And in both of those areas, really, as Hannah has set out really effectively, what we're simply trying to do is say, get all the partners around the table, make sure we're as joined up as we possibly can. If there are barriers in place that are preventing us from working cohesively together, let's get rid of them and let's put the focus on children and families and what they need. And so we're taking quite an intensive, person-centred approach, which is about partners. Doesn't matter which partner it is, actually. Let's just agree who'll do it here in this community. How can we engage best with these families? How can we identify what the issues are that are leading to them being in poverty? And how can we support them to get out of poverty? Now, that's possibly the best example I've seen of us working with the UK government and local government. Very practically, what DWP can offer is their work coaches. And in some cases, we are seeing that they are playing a really effective role in terms of supporting some of those families' access work. Happy to say more on that if you wish, but I know I haven't answered your point about prevention yet. Can I come on to that?
Please.
Yeah, thank you. I think, as Matthew said, probably the two greatest examples of prevention that I would cite from recent Scottish Government-led activity is early learning and childcare and the Scottish Attainment Challenge. And I think the Auditor-General recognises both of them as examples of very significant investment, multiple, hundreds of millions of pounds of investment in preventative activity there for children and young people. But I also recognise, as has been said, how much is being done just to deal with the current pressures and issues that families face. Hence, the payments about getting money into people's pockets, you might say are responding to an issue rather than preventing an issue happening. And so I think what we're seeking to do in the plan is wrestle with this tension. We have to get money into people's hands now, but we also want to invest as much as we can in preventative activity. We want to go further on prevention.
Before Colin comes back in, there have been a few people indicated they want to come in on this point. I think this has stirred things up, Colin. So I'm going to go to Bruce first, then I'll come to John Dickey and then to Stephen Boyle. So, Bruce.
Thanks. This point on preventative spend is absolutely essential in terms of looking at human rights-based budgeting. And it's important in human rights terms to recognise that the obligations sit at lots of different levels. Right now in Geneva, the Human Rights Council is undertaking the Universal Periodic Review of the UK, looking at the progress on human rights. And a number of countries will be challenging the UK government and Scottish government as part of that process to do more to address cost of living and specifically on child poverty. And so it's really important that when we look at the human rights obligation, which is to use all available resources to the maximum extent possible, to use every lever possible, we need to look at the responsibilities that sit at every level. And in human rights-based budgeting terms, that prevention element's really key, because setting aside the individual rights that children have and the impact that we know that addressing poverty has at a community level, it makes huge economic sense, because the failure to properly support families has massive economic cost in terms of children not fulfilling education kind of objectives and going on to fulfilling kind of economically productive careers. It has huge impact on the NHS and the physical and mental health of children and parental mental health. It has knock-on consequences into children in conflict with the law, because there is a connection between poverty and finding up in conflict with the law. We know that children experience poverty are disproportionately criminalised. And so the failure to take the rights-based approach and putting in preventative spend, putting in those safe, supportive relationships around families, has massive economic consequence. And so it's really important that we put in the preventative spend. And some of the discussions I've been having recently with early years practitioners, with youth workers, with health visitors, are all telling me the same thing, that they're not getting the support that they need after 2 years now plus of the pandemic, just being really burnt out and experiencing things that they've not seen before in terms of infant malnutrition, in terms of mental health challenges in the community. And so it's really important that we properly fund and support those that are able to get in and around families and those trusted relationships, so those community practitioners, and so particularly kind of early years, youth workers, health visitors, all under massive strain. And then also ensuring that we can provide more support within education and school-based settings, where we know that supports of things like mental health counsellors and others. So getting direct money to family, absolutely essential, and I think that more needs to be done there, but we also need to look at the support services around family and see that as real preventative spend, because the failure to address poverty and the failure to put support in around families has a catastrophic economic impact of that political choice to not address poverty in the way that it needs to be addressed.
Thank you very much. John Dickey.
Yeah, no, thanks. I mean, I think this point about prevention is one of the most important messages coming out of the report. I suppose just to add to what's been said, I think what's really important is in order to reach those 2030 targets, to really and to go further and actually end child poverty in Scotland, we'll need a kind of greater transformation in the kind of economy we have and the kind of labour market we have, so that parents are able to access decently paid jobs that have the childcare infrastructure around them that allows them to do that, but also the kind of jobs, the kind of economy that provides secure, decent, stable sources of income. And that is recognised, I think, in the Child Poverty Delivery Plan. There's reference to the economic transformation strategy. I think there's still a lot of work need to be done there to what does that actually mean in practice? How, between now and 2030, are we seriously going to change the kind of economy we have and the kind of labour market that we have that means that parents will have access to those decent jobs, and that we have the investment in childcare to enable parents to take up and increase their hours and work where they're able to? So I think that's an area we need to look into more. I suppose the other key point I'd kind of make is that we're a slight concern that you could infer from the report that investment in Social Security isn't preventative. And actually, investment in Social Security is preventative. The reality is that even in a perfect labour market, even where jobs were available, paying decent wages. The reality is, for some parents, at some points in time, they're not going to be able to earn enough from earnings in order to provide for their children, whether that's to do with ill health or disability or that balance of child caring and working responsibilities. And we need to have a social security system in place, a well-funded, adequate, rights-based social security system in place. And the investment that's been made in the Scottish Child Payment is a hugely big contribution to creating that social security infrastructure that will provide for families. And that prevent, it doesn't just, sometimes I think maybe we're responsible for sort of creating, we talked about it and we lobbied for it as a way of lifting children out of poverty. It does that, but it actually also protects a whole lot of children who are in families who are at great risk of poverty. It provides a support to them. And long term, we need that social security. It can't do all the lifting, and at the moment it has to do too much of the heavy lifting because of the problems in the labour market, because parents aren't able to access decent jobs, but it's an important part of the preventative infrastructure as well.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, to your first point, there's a lot of talk in this debate about employability, but actually 2 out of 3 children living in poverty before the cost of living crisis were living in families where at least one parent was in work. So there is that economic fundamental that needs to be addressed as well, I think. Stephen Boyle, Auditor General, please.
Many thanks, Convener. The paper that the Accounts Commission and I produced builds on a number of recent publications that we've made about shifting balance of spending towards preventative spend to achieve better longer-term outcomes, rather than, I think, as Bruce rightly says, characterise spending at the moment as interventions to treat the symptoms, rather than the longer-term planning that produces more sustainable, better outcomes for children, young people and their families into the longer term. The first thing I would say, and we say in the report, is that this is complex. I'm not understating the many factors that will influence better outcomes. Nonetheless, and one of the key messages we made in the report is that there has to be a step change to break the cycle. Otherwise, notwithstanding the government's ambitions to meet the targets by the end of this decade, to do so will be very difficult, particularly as we note the fiscal challenges that we're currently facing on the back of the pandemic, the current cost of living, all of the external factors that are influencing that. Maybe just last thing I'll say, Convener, referring back to the opinion pieces that both myself and the Accounts Commission produced, reflecting on 10 years post-Christie, we began to explore some of the accountability and incentive mechanisms that are in place. Very much welcome Paul's reference to partnerships. No one single organisation can tackle this. But what we often saw in that analysis is that when you're looking back, what really are the drivers that people will be evaluated upon for the success of them and their roles, leaders across public bodies in Scotland? It was too often that was focused on individual organisations. And that change needs to happen for some of the longer term impact we're speaking about through this report. The risk, of course, is that our successors 10 years from now will be having a similar style of conversation about how do we break the cycle of child poverty in Scotland without some of those really radical steps that we now need to take.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm going to go back to Colin, I think, who's got some more questions in this area.
Just really an extension on what we've been talking about. Scottish Government and local government obviously have key roles, and it's important that they work well together. Do they work well together? And do they work well with their third sector partners? So is there evidence of a shift away from these silos and so on that used to exist? Are they being broken down? Are we seeing joined up thinking, joined up working? And maybe Bill, you might like to comment.
I think during the pandemic, we actually saw very good examples of Scottish Government, local government, the third sector, right down to local community groups that aren't usually even recognised as contributing to well-being in the healthy communities, all working together to protect some of the most vulnerable people in our society, ensure they got food, ensure they weren't socially isolated, etc. Unfortunately, well, though we were told we were going to build back better, some of those barriers that were broken down during the pandemic have been re-erected, and we need to return to that way of working. And I'm glad to hear that that is happening in the Pathfinder areas, but it needs to happen much more widely. Because to return to what we've been talking about, up until now, we have not attempted the systemic transformational change that is needed to our economy to ensure that people don't fall into poverty. We prevent that in the first place. And if they do, you'll experience ill health, disability, caring responsibilities, etc., that there is an adequate safety net there to protect them in those circumstances, because neither of those things are in place at the moment. And that's what needs to be achieved. And we need to look at the barriers that are there that prevent people working together to achieve that transformational change, because we should not be allowing them to stand in our way. And what we also need is to actually have the rights-based approach that Bruce was talking about to budgeting, which ensures that every pound spent is contributing to transforming our economy and reducing poverty, and that every pound spent is well spent. Because, again, without knowing what is actually working and what isn't working, in other words, what impact are the hundreds of millions of pounds being put into this? What impact is that achieving? And if it's not doing what it was set out to achieve, we need to stop doing it and channel that money to what does work. And we know and identified what work. For that, we need better data, etc. Because, again, local government are sometimes operating in the dark in terms of some of this. So, monitor, evaluate. Third sector's used to doing this. We don't get any money unless we do it. Government needs to get much, much better at doing it going forward.
Ryan, what's your view?
Yeah, I think getting back to that joined-up approach, I think there's lots of talk about a triple lock for pensioners. Families should have that triple lock. They have a triple lock of the UK government, they have a triple lock of the Scottish government and local government. But at the minute, instead of lockstep to a journey where people are out of poverty, it's getting split in different directions. So we know they've got, at the minute, you've got COP, because climate is an emergency. We've been calling for something that's like, a UK strategy, probably call it like, I don't know, a COG, a conference of governments. So that's like all governments, including local authorities, coming and getting saying, what is actually the root problem of us not doing, getting families out of poverty, and lay it on the table so that, and then other people can come in and give their experts' view, just like in COP. I think that puts a bit of the pressure on it, and we have the analysis, and then it's up to government to say, OK, the Scottish Government has targets, the UK Government got rid of the targets without getting rid of poverty, but how can we actually make sure we're all on the same journey and making those, like, say, the Scottish Government's done big steps with the Scottish Child Payment, but the whole of the three governments need to do giant leaps to make sure that we actually reach our targets. So for Action for Children, we would think that we need that sort of UK round table, and people with experts' views of lived experience should be in there as well, and that would give a focus. Just like COP has given a focus on climate change, I think we need COG, or whatever you want to call it, that sort of forum to actually put the spotlight on.
Paul, that doesn't sound as seamless an operation as you seem to indicate between the different agencies. Do you have a comment there?
I'm just reflecting on Ryan's suggestion, which I think is a really good one. So, welcome views from others on that. Absolutely, we need that joined up political leadership wherever possible to really make sure that everything that can be done by all the different levels of government and, involving third sector and business are being done. To respond to your particular challenge, I see the join up. I see us working together in terms of the governance that Hannah's referred to. So we've got a programme board that is now in place to ensure that we are delivering on the plan that was set out earlier this year. And that's including representatives from local government and from third sector organisations to ensure that we're working together on the actions here. And I've referred to some of the join up on the ground, but I am challenged by what Bill says about whether post-COVID, some of the barriers are being re-erected that were torn down. The COVID recovery strategy that the government published a year ago set out an ambition to ensure that we do not see those barriers in place again. We have oversight arrangements so that where we are hearing of barriers, we will act to basically ensure that they're removed. So I think I would hesitate to speak for the Deputy First Minister who chairs that particular board, but I could say he's been very clear where we see evidence of barriers that are getting in the way of join up, that are there to help people in poverty. We want to know it. We want to do whatever we can. If that's action at Scottish Government level, we'll take action at Scottish Government level, because we must preserve some of the good stuff that we saw in terms of how public services work through COVID.
Sounds like Paul's offering himself there as the go-to person if there's any silos or barriers that you come across.
I think Matthew wants to come in.
Yeah, if that's okay. Yeah, just briefly, I think I do think that there has been an improvement, I think, in how the Scottish Government and local government are working together. And I think Paul mentioned some of the structures that have been put in place about that. But I think compared to the last plan, I think we feel there's been more of an opportunity to influence it. And I think that's reflected in how it's now much more of a plan for Scotland and how we work together more broadly. But I do think there is something about what Bill spoke about going back to some of where we were before. I think during the pandemic, there was that understanding that we were in that emergency situation. So, you know, some of the way in which funding was allocated, there was more relaxation. Some of the ways in which, you know, the approaches that came from, you know, very strict guidance, you know, statutory responsibilities, all of these things, there was an understanding it was just trying to get done what we could to support people. Whereas we are now in that stage where we are sort of returning to where we were before. And for example, one of the things that I'm quite conscious of is local authorities have this duty to create local child poverty action reports. They also have a duty under the Community Empowerment Act to do a local outcome improvement report, which is about tackling inequalities. They've got an integrated children's services report, which is about a range of children's services, but we know child poverty is central to that. And they've got work in education about how they tackle the attainment gap. So often the sort of some of the structures in terms of the reporting kind of encourages some of that silo working instead of breaking it down, I think. And then lastly, I'm sorry, very, very briefly, I think there's something about then how do we use that programme board to make sure that we're sort of levering in sort of all departments at sort of the national level, and then that feeds down into what local government is doing across different services to kind of come into one space.
Thank you. I mean, I think that leads us nicely on to a question that Sharon Dowie's got. So Sharon, I'll bring you in now.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to look at data and outcomes, basically to make sure that the actions that were taken are achieving the outcomes that we desire. And it was something that Bill just said there. It's making sure that every pound we spend is well spent and we're focusing it in the right areas. So could I ask, how can the Scottish Government and councils improve national and local data? And how do we ensure that it fully captures and measures the impact of actions on outcomes? Who wants to come in on that one, Hannah?
I'll give it a go. I think when we talk about data, it's a very complicated issue, which sort of goes without saying. But for me, there's something about drilling down into what are we talking about when we're talking about data. For me, there's sort of three layers to data. There's data that is about understanding where child poverty is, the scale of the problem, and what kind of families are experiencing it. And that kind of information is obviously helpful because it will help us direct resources, understand the scale of the problem, and design and fund the kind of interventions that we need. And there is, I think at local level, it's problematic. The data on child poverty in terms of there's a lag of, you know, up to 18 months in terms of getting that data on relative poverty. The four measures that are used in the legislation, the data that supports our understanding of progress towards them is not available at local level. For one, two it is, but the others it isn't. And also, it's fine to have a child poverty rate for a local authority area, but what you really need to make, you know, useful interventions is something more granular, you know, that tells you within an area where the poverty is and how to use it. And there's work being done by the Scottish Government, by Public Health Scotland, by the Improvement Service to try and make that picture clearer, and I'm happy to share that. There's also exceptional work, I think, being done at local level to build that picture. So Glasgow, for instance, has used its housing benefit and council tax reduction data to get a really granular picture of poverty that will change over time, and we'd like to support other areas to take a similar approach, but local conditions are different. You couldn't superimpose that to an island or rural authority, for instance, because it would make families identifiable. So I think it's a nuanced approach to data and a continuing to invest so we understand the problem. The sort of second layer of it is data that allows you to identify and reach individual families to say, okay, well, you know, our information from education tells us that this family really needs help. Let's approach them and target them with the support they need. Again, that's happening, but GDPR and data sharing is a massive issue there, both in terms of how data from DWP and HMRC can be used and how data from Social Security Scotland can be used locally. And I think that's something that there's definitely work to be done in overcoming those barriers. And the final sort of aspect of it for me is that impact that you're speaking about. And I think that's a particularly important one and particularly difficult. It's unfair, I think, to expect local authorities to be able to show that the actions that they're taking are having an impact on the sort of headline relative poverty rate in their area, because so much is out with their control. So Brexit and Ukraine and UK government policy and Scottish government policy. But it's absolutely legitimate to be able to expect them to understand how the things that are within their control, their employability processes, their childcare, the benefits they deliver, are properly evaluated and information on that is disaggregated. So we understand the impact on individual families and communities and then can use common sense to say, well, if we're doing that and we're impacting those families, then we are making a contribution to tackling child poverty. So again, it's very complex and very nuanced and it's easy to oversimplify, I think, but a lot of work to be done.
Paul?
I agree with everything that Hannah has said, and what I had in mind was the real importance of good local data. And I wouldn't underestimate the significance of the work that the Scottish Government, Public Health Scotland and the Improvement Service are doing to try and ensure that actually local areas can have a more informed approach about what's going on in their area and how to tackle it. But I also agree with what Hannah has said. From my experience of the Pathfinders, it does actually get down into a really, really granular level of data about the numbers of families in this small area, whereby sharing information, we can identify how best we can provide support. And there are absolutely issues around GDPR and information sharing that we have to work through to ensure that we're doing all we can for families while staying within the law. When it comes to a national level, I would just point the committee to the much greater level of supporting data that we published with the 2022 plan. If you look towards the end of the plan, there are 10 annexes. They are really, really, they're full in terms of the data and evidence that we've set out. So what I would say is this is an area where the Scottish Government is committed to being hugely open and transparent. The data's all there for others to drill into and to scrutinise. There is a lag, and there have been issues through COVID in terms of data collection, and so we do need to really be doing all we can to, and we will be publishing data, we'll be doing that on an ongoing basis, but we do want to do whatever we can to address the lags. So, there's work to do there, both national level, but I think particularly getting that rich picture locally so that it can be used for action is vital.
Bill?
Very briefly, I mean, I agree with everything that's been said. We need better data collection. We do need actually some expansion of some of the data we already collect to make sure that some of the smaller groups, in particular black and minority ethnic households, are not well represented in the data we collect already. So we need boosted samples so that we have a better picture of their lives. But the priority groups that are identified in the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, the risk of poverty is so much higher if there is a disabled child or disabled adult in the household, if you're black and minority ethnic household, if you're a lone parent household, if you're a larger family, or if you've got a very young child. We know the groups that are most likely to be living in poverty, and if local authorities are working to improve their lives, they will lift a proportion of that, those groups out of poverty. If they do manage to do that, they will improve the child poverty figures. So again, much better targeted use of local resources to make sure that the priority families in particular are being assisted will help. It's not exclusively them, because you know, poverty does, as I say, affect the majority of children at one point or other in their lives. But if we do manage to target more of the resources in the priority families, we will see improvement.
Thank you. I think John Dickey wants to come in on this point as well. John.
Partly, really just picking up on the point that Bill was making there, that how important it is that we collect data on who has been reached by the services that are being delivered. So when we're talking about employability service, or we're talking about childcare services, do we actually, and sometimes they're kind of put in the plan, go, we're running this employability service, we're running this, we've got this childcare, we've got it. It didn't necessarily tell you, is that reaching the families that are at most risk of poverty? So just actually making sure that services are collecting data on who they're reaching with their services, and that those match with the, ensuring that those match with the priority groups, is a really important part of this. And the other point I suppose I was making is wanting to make was just there has been real improvements in data. So I've been campaigning on this for too long, but and there is far more information about who's living in poverty, who's affected, what children are affected, where they are, than before. There are gaps, there is always more that can be done, but we shouldn't be using that as a kind of a cover for not acting. And there's a big link here between use of data and the recommendations around involving children and families in shaping policy. Because actually, we might not have all the detailed data, but we know who are at most risk of poverty at every level. We can be going and speaking to those families and asking them, actually, what are the barriers to you accessing these services? What's holding you back? What's stopping you being able to improve your earnings in the workplace, access the supports that you need, and act on that?
Can I pick up that point with Hannah McCulloch and with Matthew Sweeney? Because in para 44 of the report, it's pretty clear in its critique of quite a patchy return local authority by local authority area. So, the report says people with experience of living in poverty, the point John Dickey has just been making, were rarely involved in developing plans. Only 4 out of 27 reports available had an introduction signed by the chief executive. The level of sign-off of reports was seen as an indicator of the level of commitment to tackling child poverty. Most reports use data well in describing their local area, but then goes on to say not many reports considered monitoring and evaluation carefully. I just wonder, Matthew and Hannah, whether you've got any reflections on that. I mean, do you accept that as fair criticism? Matthew, first of all, then I'll bring Hannah in.
Happy to go first, and Hannah will have a lot to add on this as well. I think there's probably bits of it. So I think the one thing I'd say is this is the review of the first year of the plans back in 2019. There's now been 3 years. These were always going to be iterative processes in which there would be a learning and then, an understanding how that grows. I think one thing I would say is if you go back further, so there's something for me about actually local government did a lot of that work about involving people with lived experience before I think this came on the agenda nationally. So I think if you go back to the work that happened in Renfrewshire and the Poverty Commission they did there, similar work that happened in Fife and Dundee, there was really good pockets of good practice. We were putting this on the agenda first before sort of some of the duties that have came along to create the reports. But I do think there is something that more to do. I think there's always more that we can do. But I think there's something about thinking about how we engage people and do it in a way that's meaningful and don't just invite them along to a meeting. We need to make sure that we're asking you things. How do you link it into some of that broader work that you've got in terms of your duties of community planning, your specific roles about locality planning for those areas that are experiencing the poorest outcomes? How are we making sure we're doing this in a strategic and joined up way? And is that always getting captured in this plan, or is that in one of the other ones that I spoke about before? Similarly, I think I've got a bit of a query, I think, about just looking at the sign-off and whose signature is on the front of the plan. To me, what's much more important, I think, is around the process that you go through to develop it. So, you know, this duty is jointly on local authorities and health boards, and I think we've already mentioned we need all public sector partners to be involved in this as well. So I'm less worried, I think, about who signed off the plan, but more about that as they work through the development of this plan, you know, you're using those sort of community planning structures to work together, you're working across services within local government, you're working across services in health, police, etc., to try and make sure you're doing it. So I think there's always more to do, and I think probably if we probably did the same review just now, I'd hope that we've made progress since then. But I think there's definitely more for us to work from some of those points.
Thanks. That's useful to put that on the record. And Hannah McCulloch, I mean, the report mentions the Renfrewshire Poverty Commission, which I think you were a member of, informed correctly. So, and Matthew's just alluded to it as well. I mean, I don't know whether you want to... You said earlier on, I think, that you... There was a limit to what a local government level some of these big questions can be tackled. But I don't know whether you want to, A, come back on that part of the report I read out to you, and then, B, perhaps give us some of your reflections being involved at that level yourself as a commissioner.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it's a question that covers a lot of aspects. In terms of lived experience and how meaningfully that is... incorporated and taken into account. It's definitely an area where I think there is improvement. If you look at the latest round of reports, there is definitely more acknowledgement of the importance of that. There isn't a uniform way in which it's being done, and it is an area where local authorities are seeking to learn from each other, but you can see it being done more meaningfully. I think what a lot of areas are wrestling with is it about having a sort of standalone group of parents that you bring in to consult on these issues, which I think is positive and important, and some areas have done that. But it's also, as Matthew said, is about embedding that across all the policy areas that you would expect to be represented in these reports through community planning and mainstreaming involvement. So there is progress, but more progress to be made. I'm not sure, in terms of your question about the... What was the second part of your question? Exactly?
Well, your experience as somebody involved in the Poverty Commission in Renfrewshire, whether that brings with it an experience and an insight into what can be achieved at a local level.
Yeah, absolutely. I think when you talk about this legal duty to produce local child poverty action reports, I think it's important because it raises the profile of child poverty locally. It brings it to the attention of senior groups and senior leaders, and I think that's what that's why the commissions and the approaches that sort of developed organically at local level, I think, were powerful and made serious changes because that came from a senior level of leadership and commitment across the organisation, and I think that's what this legislative duty has helped to develop, and which we'll hopefully see improve as that embeds going forward.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move us on now, unless Sharon, do you want to come back in? No. I'm going to move us on now to look a little bit more about the funding aspect of the anti-child poverty strategy. And at this point, I'm going to invite Craig Hoy to put a couple of questions to you.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome everyone. If I could start with the Auditor General, if I may, and then branch out from there. Just in relation to the overall spending between the period of 2018-19 to 2021-22 on tackling child poverty, your report says that that's £3.3 billion, which by my very basic maths and often flawed, I think it's about £3,400 per child living in poverty or experiencing child poverty. Just wondering if you could perhaps give some insight into how that money has been tracked and whether or not you think that the measurement that Bill Scott referred to in the evaluation is sufficient, bearing in mind also that your report also does say that child poverty has not reduced and that there's no evidence to suggest that the actions from the delivery plan at the midpoint, admittedly, where the assessment was taken, had actually reduced child poverty. So perhaps a bit about how that money is tracked and also how effectively it's being spent.
Good morning. Thanks. I'm happy to start. I'll try and cover as much of that as I can. Referring to the report, you're right. We noted that the Scottish Government estimates that £3.3 billion was spent between 2018-19 and 21-22, the conclusion that we went on to reach from that, that it's not always clear the impact of that funding has had on reducing child poverty. Some of that we've covered already this morning, and we touched on in the briefing session with the committee a few weeks ago. Part of that is to do with data quality, and just reiterating Hannah's point about the lag in terms of when data is produced. The real importance of that then, and I think if I may just to repeat Bill Scott's point from earlier, which I absolutely agree with, that in tracking the spending, it fundamentally matters that there's good quality data to assess the impact and outcomes from that. If it's not having the desired impact, stop doing it and move on to something that can better influence it. In the report, we look to draw, I think, of that 3.3 million, and that doesn't include universal spending. And you know, it's been covered already today that there's there are many levers on tackling child poverty, some with Westminster, some with Scottish Government, and some with councils. We tried to analyse that further. I talked about the £1.6 billion spent on Scottish Child Payment and Best Start Grant, £1.5 billion directed at low-income households, and then further monies attributed to the COVID-19 pandemic. In our report, and repeating that point, Mr. Hoy, actually, that this is a huge amount of public spending, you know, and I'm clear that's the fundamental impact interest of the Public Audit Committee, that there is a lot of money at play here that can have the desired impact to reduce child poverty in Scotland. What matters, though, is that there's effective data, monitoring of that data, evaluation, and then change. Risk of repeating myself, that if it's not having the desired impact, so that it can move on to do so over the course of we move towards into the 2030s and the delivery of child poverty reduction targets. One last point I'd make, and I think you hint at it in your question about how we are making that evaluation. We don't make strong conclusions in this point about the range of indicators that are used, but we do wonder about the four indicators that are used to assess child poverty, their use, the consistent description of them, how accessible and meaningful that they are for people who are experiencing child poverty in Scotland. And just query, is that helpful in part of the for policymakers and scrutineers like yourself? Happy to elaborate on that any further as you wish.
No, that's helpful. Just in relation to the Scottish Government's perspective, Mr. Johnson, I think when Joe Griffin was before us, we discussed the pupil attainment gap and the £1 billion that had been spent in that, and we were left with the impression that he wasn't sure whether or not the money had actually been effective and or whether or not it had been spent in a way that would actually bring or close that gap. Should we have similar concerns maybe in relation to child poverty? There's clearly a will to tackle child poverty, but are we, to perhaps borrow an expression, likely to repeat the same mistakes in spending that money in a way that isn't proving to be as effective as it could be?
Well, it's a hugely important area and one where I'm very keen that we work closely with the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission to ensure that we are doing all we can. What I would say is that the detailed evidence that we've already published does set out in quite a level of granularity the impact that we expect the Scottish Child Payment and the other social security interventions to have. So it's not the case that we are committing all this money without an underpinning evidence base. So we set it out in the document. I don't have it the page to hand, but about the percentage reduction in child poverty that we anticipate the current level or the increased level of Scottish Child Payment will have. Now, what we must do is be continually evaluating whether our projections are actually realised, given all of the changing context, the cost of living pressures, inflationary pressures. So we are about to embark on quite a substantial, further exercise in terms of saying, okay, there was the evidence that underpinned the plan. These were the measures that are intended to enable us to reach the targets, but we have to keep that up to date based on what's actually happening on the ground.
Yeah, thanks for that. Just open it up to other stakeholders. There is an issue in relation to the ring fencing of funds, both to local government, which limits their ability to, perhaps with a laser-like focus, go in the local areas and target child poverty, but also in relation to the way that funds are allocated to third sector organisations. So I'm just wondering, perhaps, Ryan, it might be one for you in the sense, just to talk maybe a little bit about the way in which funds come to you, and in a fast-moving situation like COVID or the cost of living crisis, often the funds that you apply for are for specific projects, which limits your ability to then spend that on other projects. So just wondering, if, in terms of the funds you get from government and other organisations, whether or not more flexibility in the way that you can spend that would allow you to target things in a more innovative way.
Yeah, if you don't mind, I'll go a bit by the first one about the budget and allocation and stuff like that. We suggest that the Scottish Government should publish, and it sort of goes on what Bruce talked about a rights-based budgeting, a children's budget. So it actually says what the allocation the Scottish Government has given that benefits children. And so families can track how much has been spent, but key, then it's that evaluation about what's that spend actually done. So that's something that we are suggesting that should be done. For that, on the point about the flexibility and ring fencing, when COVID happened, it's true that it was cash first getting out there, and the added benefit of sort of the third sector, especially Action for Children, when it was first locked down, we got cash to deliver groceries or fuel cards to families, but it wasn't just that made the impact. We had eyes on the ground as well, and we noticed that someone had mental health issues, were struggling. So it was that extra sort of layer that the third sector provides in there. And the fact that we could be flexible in using that money, maybe it is about shopping, but we know that it is mental health, maybe taking a person out for a coffee, so they're not away from their child because it was 24/7. And that's what the pandemic sort of encapsulated about inequalities. People are in their house 24/7, but people experiencing poverty, usually an overcrowded house, it was usually damp, they didn't have devices or internet connection, they didn't have spaces to go out in the garden, and when they did have the shopping, it was a local shop that was high in prices and they couldn't have transport to go anywhere else. So that flexibility allowed us to use that money. Like, I used to work for Oxfam, and we had money given, and we said to a group of women and men, would you prefer cash or would you prefer this suite of shopping? And the woman said, no, give us cash because we can actually barter and do things. The guys were like, oh, just give us the shopping. So that's the sort of, if you give more of that flexibility, we can actually make more of that pound. And it's the families themselves that say, this is what we need, not what government says we need. So there is learning to be done from that flexibility, because quite a lot of our funding is we get funding for a set goal. Mm-hmm. And if we do another set goal, you have to then go back to another funding round, and it's the same person. So the money should follow the person and the family, not the other way around. And it seems quite transactional for this child saying, oh, we've done this, but we can't go on to this because this is another funding stream that we have to wait for and then fill in another form. And how does that make that young person feel or the family feel? It doesn't make them feel inclusive and stuff. So there is a lot of learning to be learned from what happened during the pandemic. And yeah. I know you've got to be accountable to it, but we in the third sector are very accountable, and we have all the stories and we have the outcomes. And there is that sense about cost-benefit analysis that could be done as well.
Yeah. So it does strike me as perhaps some of those barriers are going back up again. Just in relation. Oh, sorry, Bruce.
Strongly agree with all of that. The UN Committee on the Rights of the Child has actually done some really significant work on this and public budgeting in relation to the realisation of children. They did a big global study in 2015-2016 and then issued the 19th General Comment. So this is when the Committee on the Rights of the Child issues kind of authoritative statements and guidance to governments. And I think that General Comment 19 provides a really powerful framework in terms of rights-based budgeting that we should be looking more at. And the principles of public budgeting for children's rights that they set out include a lot of the issues that we've been talking about in terms of effectiveness, efficiency, equity, transparency, and also sustainability. That really important point in terms of what we hear consistently is that it's project-based funding, that it's kind of complicated, and it doesn't meet the needs in terms of that sustainability test, in terms of making sure that the support is there. And so I would strongly recommend the connection to the advice of the committee on General Comment 19. And I think, again, particularly as we move towards the incorporation of the UNCRC. And I think my frustrations at the delay in that are very well documented and very well known. 18 months after this Parliament unanimously agreed to incorporate, and over a year since the Supreme Court. But we do hope that it'll be back for reconsideration soon. And one of the key things within that legal framework is an accountability against Article 4, that obligation to use all available resources. And so I think it's really important then that we, and part of my role, is to ensure that we're providing the tools in relation to human rights-based budgeting. And we recently published a toolkit on children's rights impact assessments for local authorities as well. And I think these rights-based tools and this rights framework is really key in terms of how budget setting, and that speaks to some of these issues around ring fencing, but also around kind of making sure that we're assessing efficiency and effectiveness, also that there's proper participation of children and young people and families, and that there's that sustainability. And I think there's a really key point as well in terms of budget setting, is that lived experience from children and young people. And that can be done in lots of really powerful ways. When the Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty, the former Special Rapporteur Philip Alston, did his assessment on the UK and came to Scotland, we took him to a primary school in Glasgow, and he was sitting on the floor with the paints out, having fantastic discussions with very young children about their experience of poverty within their community. And we took four of the 10-year-old children to Geneva when the Special Rapporteur was delivering his report to the Human Rights Council. And he said in his presentation that it was their voices, their really powerful voices, and their understanding of quite complex things about budget setting, the recognition that there isn't an infinite amount of money and that decisions had to be made. But those really powerful voices are essential in framing budgets. And what they do talk about is a lot of the stuff that Ryan was saying in terms of sustainable projects that are based on those trusted relationships and all of the work that we see from early years and youth work and others. That really powerful third sector contribution is absolutely essential. But I think there's huge concerns about the sustainability of the funding. And what I'm hearing very strongly from third sector professionals, particularly in early years and youth work, is that the situation is really dire at the moment, that the funding isn't there, that people are leaving the professions, and we need to move to a different model where we're ensuring that support is there in a sustainable way.
Thanks, Bruce. I think Matthew. Just come on. Yep.
Matthew. Yeah. It, just very briefly, I think that there is something about the fact, and it comes back to some of the conversations we were having before about targeting and how we can design services based on those views and involving children and young people. I think COSLA said in some of our submissions to some of the other committees in their pre-budget scrutiny that two-thirds of our spending is in some way directed by national priorities, which makes it really hard for where is the opportunity that you have to make some of those more radical differences, to change some of those things, which makes it quite difficult. And I think there's so much in what Bruce is saying I think we agree with and would like to move towards. And I don't mean to be defensive, but it's some of the challenges that we have just now in terms of some of the processes. So there's a problem across the whole of the public sector where we've been on a period of one-year budgets for a very long time, so how do you be able to get to do that long-year planning? And similarly, I think it's a similar issue about local authorities and the options that they have to offer, you know, longer-term funding to third sector partners as well. If they've only got a year-to-year budget, it's kind of the knock-on effect. And similarly, it's some of the timescales that, you know, that we have in terms of when we get sort of known the allocation of the central grant for local government, which can be so much of our budgets now. And then the sort of the legal deadline of sort of March to set your budget, that can be sort of the budget bill can be passed in January, so we're not really knowing that information then, and then that's a 2 months period. So to go through that really important work about how are you know, setting that and doing it in a collaborative way in that very short timescale is quite a challenging ask, I think, particularly when we're going into some, you know, we've had, I think, local government 10 years of very difficult decisions to make, and I think that's probably likely to be the challenge moving forward as well.
Just in terms of those tensions that ring fencing obviously creates for local authorities, how would you seek to try and resolve that? Would it be to have less directed spending?
Absolutely. I think that's something that we know we're really keen to work with the government on, and I think that's part of an ongoing discussion that's happening just now. Absolutely. The more that we can do to move towards that sort of more outcome focus in terms of how spending and move away from some of that direction is going to be really important.
Yeah, good. Paul Johnson.
I would simply that we would want to move towards an increasingly outcome-focused relationship with local government. There is already a big focus on shared outcomes through the National Performance Framework. But we would like to have that outcomes focus with less ring fencing. So we're confident that the outcomes will be delivered and we don't have to have all of the ring fenced pots. And we are in active dialogue with local government colleagues around the so-described New Deal with local government, which the Scottish Government has referred to, together with a fiscal framework. These issues are very much to the fore in that work.
Fine. And just finally, very briefly, Mr. Osman, could you just get a reflection on the current financial position and the impact that might have in delivering the actions for the second delivery plan on meeting child poverty, particularly in areas, for example, in employability, where there is obviously a real terms cut coming through?
Yeah. So the financial situation is exceedingly grave. This committee will be well aware of the Deputy First Minister's statement in the emergency budget review just a few days ago. You'll be aware of the measures that were taken to get money into people's hands effectively. That, of course, includes the expansion of the Scottish Child Payment, the doubling of the final bridging payment in December, the extra money put into fuel insecurity funding. So really a raft of measures designed to respond to the cost of living crisis now were given great priority. But at the same time, very difficult decisions have had to be taken to save money, partly also in light of the understandable additional pay pressures that have been faced, amounting to some £700 million in total this financial year. That has meant that, in particular, some of our ambitions around additional spend on employability cannot be taken forward at this point. And that is something that we are working on very closely with partners in the Child Poverty Programme Board. There is still significant investment in employability, and we need to really max that out to the benefit of the priority families.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. We're coming towards a close. Just on that last point, Mr. Johnson, I know that you've said earlier on that you think that the data is in place to inform the second phase of the plan. But it's worth reflecting, isn't it, that the key messages of this report are quite critical about the Scottish Government. Key message number one, the Scottish Government has not yet demonstrated a clear shift to preventing child poverty. Key message two is it is not possible to assess the success of the Scottish Government's first four-year plan to reduce child poverty launched in 2018. And the report goes on to cite Bill Scott talking about there not being a link between spending decisions and outcomes and targets being met. So I think that's one of the reasons why we as a public audit committee are keen to keep a scrutiny over this, and I think why the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission want to keep this under their watchful eye as well and produce further reports on that. So I don't know whether, Auditor General, you want to say a word about that before I come to the final question I've got.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. You're right, and I think we confirmed when we briefed the committee, it is our intention to do further work on the progress that Scotland is making to reduce child poverty. Quite clearly, this isn't going to be solved by any one organisation. Scottish Government, local government partners and the third sector and others all have a really clear role to play. I was struck, actually, just kind of, there are so many organisations that are relevant to delivering child poverty reduction in Scotland. But the central component of that and the government's plans and its child poverty reduction second plan will be key to that. So it's our intention to track the progress implementation of the recommendations that we make in this briefing paper and carry out further work on progress towards the targets and the impact of public spending, the very significant sums of public spending that are still being made, quite rightly, to reduce child poverty in Scotland. And we will report publicly to the committee over the course, and we anticipate over the next 18 months or so.
Thank you. We started out this morning talking about the human face of child poverty in Scotland today and what's happening. And I just want to go around the table to ask for your reflections on the things that we've been discussing this morning, but also on this point that's made in the report, which is an analysis by the Institute for Fiscal Studies, which estimates that by October 2022, the inflation rate faced by the least affluent 10% of households could be as much as 75% higher than the inflation rate faced by the top decile of the most affluent households. So the challenges that we've been discussing this morning are going to be accelerated and made even tougher by that kind of factual assessment of what's going on out there, the discriminatory nature of the cost of living crisis and who is being penalised the most. So I'll go around the table, beginning perhaps with Bruce, if you've got any reflections on that, what you are seeing that is meaning out there, but also if you've got any final points that you want to raise looking back on the session that we've had this morning. Bruce.
Thanks, Convener. As I said, poverty was the biggest human rights issue 5.5 years ago when I started, and what I'm seeing and hearing from children and young people is really terrifying, and it's getting worse, and we have to change our response to it. Children talk about the fact that their childhood's being stolen. I mean, it is that serious. It's a right to survival and development issue. It's that serious in Scotland right now, and we have to change our approach to it. A few years ago, on the 30th anniversary of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, we asked children across Scotland to come up with 7-word stories. It's a lovely kind of way of trying to come up with a creative way, but also to encourage people to be brief, which I'm not very good at. But they came up with things like, my rights are my armour to me, this idea that rights help protect, and that it's our obligation to make sure that the children are protected by rights. They said things like, rights are help before you even ask. And I think that's a really important one, this idea that actually the obligation is on all of us in power to actually put in place the supports. The protection from poverty isn't something you should be kind of asking for. This isn't an act of charity. This is an obligation on the state and on all of us that exercise power to address that. Because the last 7-word story that I'd share is freedom from poverty helps all children flourish. And I think that's what we're really talking about, is making sure that we use all of the power that we have to the maximum extent possible, using these resources to create an environment that allow children to flourish. Because the failure to do that is absolutely catastrophic, and it's getting worse. And you're all aware of all the stories that we're hearing every day, but it's absolutely terrifying at the moment, where we're talking about malnourishment in young babies because parents and carers are watering down formula, or mothers can't breastfeed properly, all of the examples of children losing their childhoods because they're not able to engage properly. And that is a political decision, and it's a political failure, and we need radical action.
Thank you. Matthew.
Absolutely. I think it's been a very important session. I think particularly the testimonies I think have come from colleagues I think are absolutely harrowing, and I think it's something which is why this continues to be such a priority for local government in terms of what we can do more of. I think a minor point, and perhaps a bit of a sideways, but to look at obviously the inflation costs as well as being really difficult for households, and we understand that, they also have that real challenge for public services as well, and we're seeing in local government the in-year pressures that we're getting in terms of energy costs, food costs to deliver services to children, but also the pay costs, which were, you know, obviously absolutely need to be met, but that is going to lead to some really challenging decisions made in year, but also going forward we're going to have this problem for a while. So it's going to really mean some very challenging decisions made to services, many of which support the children that we're talking about today, and how we manage that is going to be really difficult and really important.
Thank you. Ryan.
Yeah, you talk about the inflation pressures, and we're in the audit committee, and we're talking about budgets. The best experts of budgeting are families living in poverty, everything down to the last penny. So when anything above inflation, that really cuts to them. And we haven't mentioned also there's a poverty is expensive, ironically. There's a poverty premium, and I think the latest studies by Bristol University said that cost for Scotland, Scottish families, is like 242 million, and for the UK it's 2.8 billion, and that's because families living in poverty have prepayment meters, can't get access to low credit, can't buy bulk food, can't buy one-off quality items. They have to buy multiple items that are less quality and that actually cost more money. So getting back, I'm angry, the parents are angry. One of the mums that I asked, what should we say to politicians here? And I'll just leave you with this. They said, why don't politicians live in our shoes for a while and see what we have to put up with? And I bet you things would change then. So I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you. Hannah.
I suppose just a few points that haven't come up when we're talking about the cost of living. It's important to remember the distinction between urban and rural families as well. Quite often the measures we use to understand poverty hide the cost of living because they're more income-based. So those that live in very rural areas and have very higher heating costs, higher transport costs, higher childcare costs, we need to make sure we don't lose sight of that. When we're making policy and delivering services. I suppose more generally, what we're likely to see in terms of those working locally to address child poverty is by necessity a focus on crisis and getting money into people's pockets and food into people's mouths. And I think that's unavoidable and an absolutely essential role for local government and national government too. I suppose it's how do we keep the focus on long-term prevention when the human suffering is so great now, but I think it's something we have to keep challenging ourselves to do. And also just to break down a wee bit the distinction between, and some people have already talked about this, what's mitigation and what's prevention. We need to use every interaction that we have with families, whether they're in a crisis situation or not, to help tackle poverty in the longer term. So not a question of just giving someone a payment or just giving someone a food voucher, making sure there's support and advice and help to find employment or childcare or mental health support as part of that offer, so continuing to be holistic in our crisis response.
Thank you very much. Bill.
Yeah, I very much agree with everything that's been said. I work with a lot of these people on a regular basis, and I know the dedication that's there to try and affect things. I am extremely worried, like Bruce, about what's going to happen over this winter. I think what the Scottish Government has done in managing to protect the Scottish Child Payment funding, the increase to £25, is extremely important. The bridging payment being doubled is extremely important. The fuel and security fund, extremely important, because I think it will save lives. That's how desperate things are for those families at the moment. They have not got enough to live on. They cannot heat their homes. They cannot feed themselves. Trussell Trust and the other food banks are moving to providing people with food that they do not need to heat, because they know that families have stopped using their cookers because they can't afford to run them. And the National Institute for Economic and Social Research estimates there are now 1.5 million households, that's over 3 million people in the UK, who simply cannot afford their fuel and food costs on a weekly basis. Not intermittently, every single week, they have not enough money to meet those two basic essentials. And what that means is that families are not living in destitution intermittently, they're living in it constantly. And that has a huge impact on their health and their mental health. And to just concentrate, I appreciate the extremely difficult choices that Scottish Government have had to make. But, you know, it's not just the cut to employability spending that worries the Commission, because that was aimed to achieve structural change. It's also the cut to mental health funding, because mental health costs the Scottish economy £8.8 billion a year. That's the scale of the impact on people's lives, but also on our economy. And, you know, these are difficult choices. I understand the fiscal difficulties that Scottish Government are in, but for every choice that's made, there are consequences, and we do need to begin poverty-proofing every single thing we do, instead of thinking of it as something separate that happens to a few people. We need to place it at the heart of all the financial planning that the Scottish Government undertakes. Thanks.
Thanks, Bill. Paul.
So isn't it the case that in response to all that we've heard, we should be held to account for the progress that we make? And so I reiterate that I welcome the scrutiny and challenge from the Accounts Commission and the Auditor General for Scotland on this, and from this committee. I sat down last week, hosted by One Parent Family Scotland, with a group of mothers currently experiencing poverty. And their stories resonate with many of the stories that we've heard today, but let me finish with two hopeful points that I also took from those discussions. The first was the fact that with unemployment at historically low levels, some of those who I was speaking to have been successful in securing work. And the challenge, I think, is for that work to be increasingly flexible so that it fits with childcare responsibilities and for the transport and childcare offer to fit around it. I think we're making some progress there, with more to be done. But the second area of hope was around the Scottish Child Payment, the fact that for parents now recognising that really with effect from next week, we're looking at that £25 per payment per child if they are eligible for it, and many are. And so very practically, I think one of the things we can all do is make sure that the availability of that payment is made as widely known as possible, and we're supporting all parents who are eligible for it to get it, along with the other payments that are available at the moment, as Bill has mentioned.
Thanks very much for that. John Dickey. John.
Yes, as Bruce said, these levels of unacceptable levels of child poverty existed pre-COVID, pre-cost of living crisis. What the having this tolerating this level of poverty in our country left our children so brutally exposed to these crises. And as one parent recently at a JRF event described, it's not a cost of living crisis, it's a cost of surviving crisis for them. They're not living, they're surviving. We know that families with children on average spend 30% more on energy than other households. We know from modelling by Resolution Foundation that it's children who are more likely to be getting pushed into poverty. We know that even with the energy price guarantee, that a family of four needs to find an additional £1,400 this winter in order to stay warm and fed, and that's not there. What we do know is that when we respond to crisis, we need to do it in a rights-based and a cash-first way. That's what works. That's what the feedback through COVID was, that actually ensuring that families have cash in their pocket, have the agency to make the choices, make the judgments calls. Is it the energy bill? Is it food? Is it a new pair of shoes for the children? That's the response. And it's actually that approach, those principles that need to be applied both in a crisis, but also need to underpin the long-term action that's needed to actually deliver on the child poverty ambitions that I think we all share in this room.
Thank you. And Stephen, final word to you.
Many thanks, Convener. I'm very grateful to the committee for organising this session. I found the testimony of colleagues hugely insightful. To restate, Audit Scotland, myself and the Accounts Commission have a long-term interest on the progress that Scotland is making in tackling child poverty, and we'll continue that programme of work to see the impact, better outcomes for Scotland's children. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, on behalf of the committee, can I thank all of the witnesses for your time and your very rich contributions talking about poverty. It's brought out, I think, some very strong messages, not just for us as a public audit committee, but for us as a Scottish Parliament, about the urgency of what needs to be tackled and the kind of transformative changes that we need to see. So, can I thank you very much indeed, and I now want to move the committee meeting into private session. Thank you.